which is what it was. So you don't have a Greek nation or a Turkish nation, whatever, from the beginning of history. So the idea of one character is broken down. It's also broken down in other ways, because the two communities are not presented as homogeneous. So basically it shows divisions between, for example, the church and the Greek Cypriot left. It shows internal divisions in each side, so you don't have this idea of one character either. And when it comes to violence, again, these books are interesting, because instead of saying Greek Cypriots killed blah blah blah, as the previous book, it says certain Greek Cypriots. And of course, that's a very important distinction to avoid generalizing. And it even includes instances when Turkish Cypriots killed Turkish Cypriots, which was one of the most controversial aspects of these books, I think. So again, it shows that, that violence doesn't come, you know, it's not a community against another community, and also your own community may be violent against your own people. So basically, there is no protagonist, no character from beginning to end of the story, which means that this story may not have a clear meaning. It may not support a political goal clearly. In other words, this story also includes the periods of the persecution of Turkish Cypriots in the 60s. It doesn't avoid that. But it then leaves history open. It doesn't say history dictates that we should unite or we should divide. It leaves it open as a political choice, which is, you know, I think a more democratic way of teaching history. And it shows, in a way, all Cypriots suffering. It personifies Cyprus to try and show that suffering was not just of one and the other side. So, you know, how have we come to this, you know, sad situation? And it presents some factors. And as you will see, it's all symmetrical, all of it, except from one point here, where Greek Cypriots are blamed more. But still, it's quite interesting that it suggests that it's all symmetrical, rather than the pure victimization of Turkish Cypriots that the previous books were presenting. So here it says, you know, there is a lot of blame and a lot of suffering on everybody. Okay, and Greek Cypriots a little bit more. But still, it's a huge step from the previous books. In the Ottoman period, we have, you know, coexistence. And this is interesting, the way it describes 74, and this is something I always ask my students to discuss together. Now, for the first time, Greek Cypriots tasted the bitterness that Turkish Cypriots had experienced for many years before. They, like Turkish Cypriots, for years previously, were forced to abandon their homes and villages, and due to the war, they also lost their loved ones, like Turkish Cypriots did. So what is the point of this? It's a very interesting, you know, formulation. Some people interpret it as a kind of revenge. They deserve, because of what they did before. Other people interpret this as something basically against war. But in war and conflict, in the end of the day, everybody loses. Others interpret it as an effort to create empathy. In other words, because the Turkish Cypriot experience is so well known to Turkish Cypriot, they're trying to use this experience to help them understand Greek Cypriot suffering. When I asked the authors of these books, they said that is the last one that they were trying to accomplish, the idea of empathy, using the Turkish Cypriot experience. I think I'll skip some of these. Some of the problems of these books, they are still ethnocentric, though from a Turkish Cypriot perspective. They have the national anthem, the flags, Atatürk in the opening. When I asked the authors again, they said that this is by law. So they have no choice about this. They ignore gender almost totally, other minorities, immigrants. So, you know, they also have their own problems. I'm not saying they're perfect, but I do think that they're the most interesting effort to produce a multi-perspectival approach to the history of Cyprus ever attempted in terms of history education. So despite their problems, I think they are the most positive effort that has ever been made. So basically they break with this idea of a biography of the nation, and this is important for various reasons: blame and retribution and revenge. If, let's say, the Greek Cypriots think of the Ottomans as Turks, okay, and themselves as always Greek, so that the Christians who lived in the Ottoman period were Greeks. In other words, if they think in terms of these characters that exist throughout history, what the Ottoman Turks, let's call them, did in the Ottoman period is like an injury to me now, if I'm Greek, and these are what they did to the Greeks. And of course, this creates a lot of issues of revenge and retribution. And sometimes, if you read stories about people who killed people of another ethnic group, they were saying, but you know, historically they killed us, you know, for centuries. Why should we now? We should have to take revenge. It's almost a historic duty. So this is very important that this new set of books breaks with this paradigm. That is also a paradigm which creates this sense of harm for something that may have happened hundreds, if not thousands, of years ago. Then it stops this question, you know, who came first? You know, were we here first? Were you there first? Blah, 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 which is often a question about ownership of a place. And it's also a story of change. In other words, if the actors are not the same from beginning to end, if identity is something that always shifts, it means it leaves it open as something that people can create themselves. So, and anyway, and it also is in a way a real history in the sense that the stories, the stories based on ethnic nationalism, in a way it's like there is no history. It's like everything matters for the present. When you tell somebody, okay, this is history, okay, it means it's okay, we can leave this behind us now. With the stories based on ethnic nationalism, nothing is history. Everything is because the self, the national self, is the same from beginning to end. It's one character. And that used then the film, and that close with this film metaphor, to hopefully try to make this a bit clearer. These are the books, you know, after, of course, Cedebello's power, Juppé came. These books are exactly the same like the previous black and white books, very ethnocentric, war-centered, okay. A protagonist, antagonist, suffering. I mean, I won't go through this again. So basically, we return to this older paradigm, but with books that are more flashy and possibly are more appealing to children. And they were made so in such a hurry that they picked images, like these images of people in the Wild West with wagons. And they said that these are images of, you know, people coming from Anatolia. So they were made in such a kind of, you know, there's some very funny, you know, things about them. And I'll finish with trying to illustrate again the whole talk with the Hollywood films. And what are, you know, Hollywood films, action thrillers. Okay, think of whatever, Van Damme, think of Arnold Schwarzenegger, I don't know. And basically, these are meaningful stories. This is important. It's basically stories with a very clear meaning that you want to see when you're really tired and you don't want to think. And this is important. It's not like a French film that you come out and you're you know, what did they mean? And, you know, I'm not sure. Okay. They're based on violent conflict, a strong protagonist, which who pushes the plot. No little or no mental effort required. And the viewer is a consumer, not a producer of meaning. In other words, it doesn't leave any open space for reflection or to create, to put your own meaning in those films. Everything is totally closed and basically offered to you on a plate. No ethical dilemmas. You know, after you watch them, you're not going to be thinking, wait a second, you know, should he have been killed or not, but maybe not. It's, everything is very clear. bad guy has to be killed, and it's quite interesting that they're so manipulative that you not only want the bad guy to be killed, you want him to be killed in the most horrific way, and you actually rejoice when he's killed in the most horrific way. Which, if you think about it, is kind of, you know, very manipulative. The characters do not change, okay? So they're like the national story from beginning to end. The nation is there, the character is there. Again, the characters are clear-cut, like the national stories, you know, good, bad, okay? And, okay, there's stories of revenge and punishment.